26 and of Luke 22. Then Jesus said to them, "But now he that has a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you that this is written, must be accomplished in me. And he was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end." They said, "Lord, behold, here are two swords." And he said to them, "It's enough." Now to verse 47. While he was yet speaking, behold, a multitude. And he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them, and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, "Judas, do you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" When they which were about him saw what would follow, they said to him, "Lord, shall we smite with the sword?" And one of them smote the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. Jesus answered and said, "Suffer ye thus far." He touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests and captains of the temple, the elders which were come to him, "Be ye come out as against the thief with swords and staves. When I was daily with you in the temple, you stretched forth no hands against me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." So we'll begin in verse 47, and we'll just go over this phrase by phrase. Obviously, we're going to get a lot of input from y'all as well, so make sure to pipe up. But we're beginning looking at Judas and Judas's betrayal. Judas comes. He comes bringing a multitude of soldiers, a multitude of religious leaders. They come out with swords and spears, weapons. They come out to arrest Jesus. Now, it's interesting. Luke's account's different than Matthew's account, Mark's account, and John's account. One of the things I do want to mention, it's not in Luke's account, but elsewhere, when Jesus goes to them and asks, "Who are you speaking?" And they say, "Jesus." And it's translated, and then the English translation is, "And they fell back to the ground." And I'm sure you probably heard sermons on the power of Jesus' name. When Jesus said, "I'm the one you're looking for," it was like being slain in the spirit, and God struck him down. That's not the actual Greek phrase. The Greek phrase there that is translated "fell to the ground" is a military term and was the idea that when Jesus said, "I am he, I'm the one you're looking for," that the Roman soldiers fell back into a defensive military formation. Okay, which is why when Peter swings his sword, he doesn't attack the Romans. He attacks an unarmed servant guy that's standing out away from the garrison of the Roman soldiers, who the moment they realize, we're going up against this guy, there's two guys with swords, they immediately fall into a defensive position. Judas, in this, comes up to betray Jesus. Again, we are used to America, and we are used to flashlights and lanterns and spotlights and night vision and all of those things. These are people carrying torches at night. There would probably not be that many torches, and they'd be very light little lanterns, maybe even just a candle in a lantern. And when you're thinking of a culture where all of them are Jews, okay, and all of them have very long beards, if you were trying to identify in the middle of the night out of a group of 13 people, 12 people, which guy with the long beard wearing the brown robe is Jesus, it would be very difficult unless you were close to them, because all of them would have looked exactly alike almost during the daytime, because they all would have been Middle Eastern Jews with long beards wearing the same clothing. Okay? Then you go in the nighttime, it would have been extremely difficult. Judas, being very close to the disciples, told them, "I'm going to go pick out who Jesus is. And the way I'm going to do it is he's going to be the one that I greet with a kiss." Again, as we talked last week when we were talking about the holy kiss, this is a sign of close friendship, and this is the way you would greet family members and people who you are very close to. So Jesus takes exception to this in verse 48, because it's one thing to betray someone to their face. It's another thing to stab someone in the back while giving them a hug, and that's what Judas does. And Jesus takes exception to that and really calls Judas out for the evil of betraying him in this manner. In other words, he's pretending still as he hands Jesus over to be crucified. He's still pretending to be his friend. And this is important as we move forward in talking about the rest of this passage, but I want to take a little time to talk about just our lives as Christians. We're going to get hurt by other people. You're going to be betrayed by family members, friends, co-workers, etc. But one of the greatest hurt that we experience is at the hands of other professing Christians. Church hurt is one of the greatest pains you will ever go through. Most of you have probably been through some level of church hurt, where you were harmed or hurt, or something took place in a church that really burned you. One of the things that we need to note, and we'll get to this in just a minute, in verse 53, Jesus talks about how this is their hour and the power of darkness. We, as Christians who live and walk in the light, sometimes do not grasp the total depravity of darkness and evil. One of the hallmarks of Christianity is a free and open confession of sin. Our standing before God is not based upon our performance. Because of this, we are not ashamed, though we have shame, but we're not at the place where we would not confess our sin. We would acknowledge that we are sinners. We would acknowledge, oh, I should not have said that. Please forgive me for saying that. You know what? That was not the right way to handle this. We acknowledge that because that's just part of God's grace in our lives. We live in the light. We walk in the light. We may be ashamed of our past, but our testimony is our testimony. And what God has saved us from and God has delivered us from is what God has saved us from and God has delivered us from. This is 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us. And so we live in this world of open confession. We are a people of truth. We do not try to hide what we believe. We are people who are constantly, this is what the Bible says about marriage. This is what the Bible says about gender. This is what the Bible says about sex. This is what the Bible says about murder. And so we have no concept of hiding once you've been a Christian for a long time, because your standing before God is not based upon your performance, it's based upon Christ. So you walk in the light, you're freely talking with others, you talk about the mistakes you made, and as Christians, you forgive. Okay, we're forgiving people. And so when somebody makes a mistake, we go, it's okay, because we realize what God has saved us from. And so we are a very forgiving, open, honest people. At least we should be. And so when we think of this, as the scripture would put it this way, to the pure, all things are pure. When I live in the light, and I am walking in openness and honesty and transparency, confessing faults, confessing failures, confessing sins, not trying to hide things, freely forgiving others who confess their sins, it does not cross my mind that there may be people, wolves in sheep's clothing, who infiltrate the church and lie. Why? Because we would never do that. If we had a problem with the leadership at a church, we wouldn't go to church there. And we would tell them. If something went the way that we didn't think it should go within the church, we would go to that person and we would speak to them in love and grace. And so we just assume that everyone that has the white woolly clothing on is like us, walking in the light, not going to do those things. And so what happens is we do not account for the situations like Judas, because we would never walk up and give someone a hug to stab them in the back. And so we freely give them a hug, expecting them not to stab us in the back. Judas, though, is a prime example of what happened to David. Remember David in the Psalms? Who was it that hurt him? Who do you say it was? His familiar friend. The one who ate bread with him. Okay? You begin to look at it when Absalom, who's Absalom, by the way? David's son. Who's the one that tries to take the kingdom? His own son. And what happens? His best friend, who's a counselor, who conspires with Absalom to take over the kingdom and kill David. David's best friend. And David, that's where the hurt comes from. He's like, you know what? If a foreign invading army tried to come, I'd expect that. But I didn't expect it from a close friend. And this is why church hurt is so great. Because it doesn't come from an expected source. We expect that all the people in the media are going to call us homophobic. We just expect that. We expect lost coworkers to cuss us out every day. Like, we just expect that. When, instruction, I expected to be cussed out all day. That's just what I expected. These are lost people. They don't love Jesus. I'm trying to share the gospel. They're going to mock me for it. But what happens when someone who comes saying, I love Jesus, then begins to mock you? Then we don't have a category for that, because as Christians, to the pure, all things are pure. And I hope that kind of helps you understand a lot of the church hurt, but it also helps us to understand why we need to be wise as serpents and gentle as doves. A very interesting thing to note about Judas is, if you notice that the disciples, not just the disciples, but Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when they wrote these, they went back and they put things like Judas was stealing out of the money. How do you think they figured that out? Well, they probably saw some accounting errors and just went, it's Judas. Judas isn't stealing. Judas is just bad at math. I mean, isn't that what you would do with a close person that you trusted who loved the Lord? And things don't add up at the end of the day. You go, you know what? It happens. Sometimes, you know, somewhere back in the line, we wrote the wrong thing down on the ledger. I mean, that's what you do with your spouse. That's what you do with someone you trust. And now they look back and they go, it was there all along. And some of us have had that, where we look back and we go, we knew it. But why did we not act on it? Well, because to the pure, all things are pure. So I want us to see that at the very beginning, that there is going to be wolves that infiltrate the flock. We're going to get to the end. We're going to see a lot more about that. Let's go ahead and go to the end of this passage, and we'll come back and deal with the sword issue, okay? In verse 52, Jesus looks at the chief priests, the captains of the temple. By the way, these are the people who claim to be the light. These are people, the ones who claim to be righteous. These are the people who claim to be obedient to the Bible, claim to follow Scripture, which, by the way, Jesus' trial is entirely illegal in Scripture and Jewish tradition. You have to have trials in the daytime. If you have false witnesses, the false witnesses are supposed to be punished. All of these things take place, and it's an illegal trial by the Bible thumpers, okay? And Jesus begins to call them out on it. He says, are you coming against me as a thief with swords and staffs? In other words, why are you going through such lengths to get me? Verse 53, I was with you every single day this week in the temple. Every single day, Jesus was teaching in the temple. Why didn't they object? Why didn't they confront him? Why did they have to send people to try to lie and catch him in his words? Why was it they were trying to get him in trouble with the Roman Empire, but never would just come out and oppose him? Do y'all remember why? What were they scared of? The people. Why? The people like Jesus. And what happens if they were to go against Jesus publicly? A rebellion against their leadership. Okay? More ears would be cut off. You're exactly right. More ears would be cut off. So what is Jesus' explanation for why they show force at nighttime as opposed to doing their actions out publicly? This is the explanation for why the trial is going to be held at night, why they're going to use false witnesses. Again, if Jesus is this lying blasphemer, why are they hiring false witnesses? Why do they need to lie? If Jesus is such an evil guy that's leading the whole country astray, why do they have to lie? The answer is here. This is your hour and the power of darkness. That's the way darkness operates. How does the devil come? As an angel of what? Light. He does not come as an angel of darkness. Okay? The whole little thing where you got the angel on one shoulder and the devil on the other shoulder is not correct. What you have is an angel on one shoulder and an angel on the other shoulder. Okay? And obviously that's not correct either. But the general idea is that that's the way the devil comes. Okay? Because he cannot come saying, I want to drag you into hell with me. I want to destroy your marriage, destroy your life, destroy your body, destroy the image of God in you. I want to destroy every human being and everything in God's creation. I want to destroy its order, and I want to destroy its beauty because it reminds me of the God I hate. He can't do that. Okay? What does he do in the Garden of Eden with Eve? He doesn't come saying, I am trying my hardest to kill you, because That's what he was trying to do. He knew if she ate, she would die. Why does he come with the light? Because that's the way darkness truly operates. And we've got to kind of change our mindset in this regard. We have become as gentle as doves, but not wise as serpents. We have become where Christians sometimes are becoming the most naive people. That if someone stands up with a coat and tie on and a PhD and says, this is what the Bible says, we go, oh, who am I to say otherwise? No, we have to be very, very careful. We have to acknowledge that the devil comes lying. And by the way, the lies that he tells are so encroached with truth that it takes a very close walk with the Lord to discern it. Remember, when Jesus was at the Last Supper and he said, one of you is going to betray me, what was the question the disciples asked? It's an interesting question. What question did they ask? They didn't ask who. They said, is it me? Okay? So let's play this game. One of you in this room is going to be an axe murderer by the time the day is over. How many of you are going, well, is it me? No. You're looking around going, well, I could see Anthony doing that. You know, that's what we think, you know. Judas has such good cover that they suspected themselves more than they suspected Judas. Now, I don't know about you, but there are very few people that I have looked at and gone, yeah, I'll go bad before they go bad. But that's how good Judas's cover was. I would betray Christ before Judas would. That's the question they asked. Now, here's another thing. What does Jesus tell him? He says, the one who's going to betray me is who? The one that he... What? Dips his hand with me. And what does he do? He, right after he says that, he takes the cracker, he dips it in the juice, dips it in the wine, and who's he handed it to? Judas. He goes, guys, you want to know who it is? It's the person I give this to. Judas, do what you're going to do. And what was their response? When Judas gets up immediately and leaves, what was their response? Yeah. He's going to go pay for the meal. He's going to help the poor. That's how good Satan's lies are. That all of the apostles being told by Jesus, this guy is going to betray me. Now go do what you're going to do. And they go, oh, he's going to go give money to the poor. So, don't feel bad if you ever get snookered in and deceived. You know why? All the apostles were deceived, even when Jesus pointed out. One of the things that is, turn with me. This one's always blown my mind. Go to Acts chapter 20. Okay? Acts chapter 20. And let's see here. Which verse is it? Acts chapter 20 and verse 29. This is Paul, and Paul is talking to the elders at Ephesus. Notice this. I know this, that after my departure shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Okay? We know that. Satan is going to try to destroy the church of God. The Apostle Paul is leaving Ephesus. He's leaving the Ephesian elders, and he says, you know what? After I'm gone, wolves are going to come trying to destroy the flock. But notice verse 30. Also of your own selves. Who is their own selves? Who are you talking to? The elders of Ephesus. What is going to happen? Men will arise speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. He looks at the elders at Ephesus and says, some of y'all are going to be wolves. Now, this is where I struggle. So I'm looking at Paul going, Paul, if you know some of these guys are wolves, why aren't you calling them out right now and protecting the flock? You know the answer? He didn't know. Even the Apostle Paul couldn't recognize which one of these were wolves and sheep's clothing. Okay? I say all that to say that you are going to be bit in church by what you thought was a sheep. That's just a fact of life. Why? Because Satan wants to infiltrate the flock. This does not mean that we should not study to show ourselves approved. It does not mean that we should not study the fruits of the Spirit, because we'll know them by their fruit. It does not mean that we should not examine and pull on the fleece and do everything within our power. It doesn't mean that we just go, okay, well, here's a wolf without a sheep's clothing. Come on in. No, we have to be very careful. But I want you to just to understand how deep and insidious the level of evil is. Okay? You and I do not like what Catholicism and Mormonism and Jehovah Witnesses and Islam and all of these things do to the souls of men. But I have never been tempted to pretend to be Muslim in order to go into a mosque and destroy it. That just doesn't even cross my mind. I have never in my mind said, you know what, I'm going to go to Salt Lake City and I'm going to infiltrate Mormonism by pretending to be a Mormon. But that's the way Satan thinks. That's the way he thinks. And this is where the call from this passage of Scripture, as I see it, is a call to be as wise as serpents. Don't lose the general effect. Unfortunately, when we get bit, the first thing that grows out the window sometimes is our gentleness doves. We become cynical, bitter, not trusting, withdrawn people. Notice the apostles did not do that after Judas. After Judas, what did they do? Okay, let's be real here. What happens for the next 40 days with these 11 disciples? Do they become closer together and spend more time together? Or do they scatter and spend less time together? They go back to their jobs, but where do we find them on the day of Pentecost? Together. Where do we find them when Jesus rises from the dead? Together. I mean, these are people who pushed in towards each other. Yes, they kind of gave up on the idea of Jesus being the Messiah in the interim and where to go back to go fishing. But when they went fishing, who did they take with them? Each other. When they went back to their line of work, they took the other disciples with them back to their line of work. Which is interesting, because when you see them out fishing, okay, you realize that a lot of the disciples weren't fishermen. And yet it would seem to indicate from the text that people like Matthew were there. He wasn't a fisherman. And so what you see is that they did not do what we do. At the initial, yes, strike the shepherd, the sheep will be scattered. Yes, the disciples go and separate. But they maintained their walking in the light. They maintained their gentle as doves, even though they've been burnt. And I really want to challenge us in that regard, because one of the easiest things to do when you have been bit by a wolf is to say, I'm never going back in another sheepfold again. I'm never going back to church. No, it's going to happen. Paul speaks of it. It's going to happen. We're going to be hurt. And we need to understand that's just the way darkness works. We would never in a million years think the way Judas thinks. If we were going to hand somebody over, like I've had to report people to the police before. And I told them to their face, I'm stepping outside to make a phone call. And this is who I'm calling, and this is what I'm doing. Why? Because we're Christians. We don't act that way. And so when it comes and you encounter it, it's very disorienting. So I want you to see that. Any questions on that before we look at the sword part? All right. Well, now let's shift gears and let's look at the swords, okay? We looked previously on how Jesus told them to sell their shirt and buy a sword. We talked about how it is okay for Christians to be armed. But we also noted that they had two swords among 12 disciples, or technically 11, and Jesus said that was plenty. So, now, in verse 49, what is their question when all of this Roman garrison and all these guys come with swords and spears and all that? What is their first question? Should we attack? Now, awfully bold for two armed people and 10 unarmed people, or 11 or 9 unarmed people, to attack armed Romans. Okay? We tend to poo-poo the disciples a lot, but there is a lot to be said for the fact that they were like, well, Jesus told us to get swords. We got swords. They're coming to arrest Jesus. Maybe Jesus wants us to attack. Now, before we look at all the response, isn't that sometimes the way we think as Christians about guns? Well, if Jesus says, sell your shirt and buy a sword, what's the modern equivalent of that is, you know, do whatever you need to buy a gun. Okay? Well, what good's a gun if you're not going to use it? Right? So, would Jesus have us use armed force? Okay? Well, in these circumstances, what is happening? Jesus is doing what? What has Jesus been telling them for years? What is going to happen? He's going to go to Jerusalem. What's going to happen? He's going to be betrayed. And then what is going to happen in the betrayal? He's going to be handed to who? He's going to be handed over to sinful men. And what are they going to do with him? They're going to kill him. They're going to crucify him. He's been telling the disciples this repeatedly. And when Peter confronts him and says that's not going to happen, what is it that Jesus calls Peter? Get behind me, Satan, because you do not savor the things that are of God. What has he just told them a few hours earlier in the Last Supper with his broken body and his shed blood, and what is Judas going to do? Betray him. So Jesus has also told them, woe to the one who does this. But this is so that the scriptures will be fulfilled. Jesus has told them repeatedly, I am going to be betrayed. I'm going to be arrested. I am going to be put on trial. I am going to be condemned. I am going to die. And every single time they try to confront him about it and say, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. He keeps telling them, this is what God sent me to do. I came to do this. I came to die. This is what the scripture says that happened. I'm obeying scripture. I'm submitting to the will of the Father. Hey, guys, sit right here and watch me pray. Lord, I'll drink the cup. Lord, I'll drink the cup. They would know all of this. Like, they've seen it. They've observed it, all of it. But now, what are they wanting to do? They're wanting to keep him from being arrested. And how are they going to do that? With physical force. Now, Peter, it doesn't say it in Luke, but we know from other accounts, Peter does not wait for Jesus to answer. Okay? Jesus does give an answer. And does anybody remember what the answer is? Harold, what is it? If you live by the sword, you'll die by the sword. Okay? Tells Peter to put his sword away. But Peter doesn't wait for an answer. And he goes out and attacks. Now, it's interesting to me that he does not attack the Romans, who are in a formation of defense. He attacks a servant. And it would appear from the text that the young boy, almost, probably early teenager, and he cuts off his ear. What does Jesus do with this guy who's coming to arrest him and have him murdered? He heals him. Now, you talk about the one who said, turn the other cheek, do good to those who do evil to you. Jesus is living that. Jesus is actually living that as this young man comes to have him arrested, taken to an illegal trial, and executed. Jesus heals him. Okay? But what is it in verse 51? The King James is a little difficult for modern English, but what is verse 51? What does Jesus answer in modern English? I'm going to tell you what he's saying. Memorials. Let this happen. Guys, like, it's okay. By the way, when Paul is on his way to Jerusalem, what are all of the prophets telling Paul on the way to Jerusalem? You're going to be arrested. Okay? And so what does everyone try to do for the Apostle Paul? What do they try to do? They try to keep him from going where? Because they don't want him to get arrested. And what does he say? He said, no, this is what God's will is for me. I have to go. And it is God's will, because that's how he ends up propagating the gospel into Western Europe. is through Paul being arrested and taken to Rome. Okay, that's in for the success of the gospel. There's a lot of people, Praetorian Guard and other people, who end up hearing the gospel because Paul was willing to be arrested. So what does this mean as it relates to the use of armed force? Now, we don't have time this morning to go into what is known as just war theory. So we do not have to figure this out for ourselves. Much wiser and godlier men have sat down and thought of these issues long before we did. And one of the things that they have determined, and I believe it's correct, is that God forbids the offensive use of weapons as it relates to taking human life, physical violence towards others. There's a defensive use, but he forbids the offensive use. Okay? In other words, thou shalt not kill applies across the board whether you are a nation's military or you're a private citizen. That it is just as wrong for us to invade Mexico because we want their gold as it is for me to kick in your front door because I want your gold. It's just as wrong. And so Christians have for centuries said that the idea of being on the offensive, okay, to attack someone unprovoked, to take things from them, is wrong, even if a government wants to do that. That a Christian would say, I cannot participate that in fair conscience as a member of the military, as a citizen. We are not going to do that. Now, when are Christians permitted to use arms? The answer is in defense of human life. Okay? Why was it that Jesus wanted them to be armed? Well, we looked at it a couple weeks ago, and what was it that Jesus did? Again, it's not recorded in Luke, but what was it that Jesus did when he was arrested? Okay, he comes forward and he says, I'm the one you're looking for, and then he says something about the disciples. What does he say about the disciples? Let them go. Okay? He's the good shepherd, and what does the good shepherd do? He gives his life for the sheep. And so what is Jesus? Jesus is getting ready to go and die for Peter's sins. Okay? And so in the love for Peter, he says, I will willingly give myself up if Peter can go scot-free. Which, by the way, Peter had attacked a man and cut off his ear. What do you think should have happened to Peter, or would have happened to Peter, if Jesus had not interfered? Okay, well, let's do another thing. Let's say you're getting arrested, and one of your friends jumps out and stabs a cop. What do you think's happening to your friend? Going bye-bye. What is it that Jesus is trying to do here? He's trying to protect the disciples. So the whole of them being armed has nothing to do with, okay, we're going to go and take over the Roman Empire. What it has to do with is I do not want my disciples getting caught in the crossfire, as it were. I want to go and do what God has called me to do, and I'm giving my life for the sheep, and that is not just in the death on the cross, that is also in the way I conduct myself to the cross. I am going to do whatever is necessary to protect the lives of these people. Later on, when it's time for Peter to die, Peter goes willingly. Later on, when it's time for James to die, James goes willingly. When it's time for John to go to prison, John goes willingly. When it's time for Paul to be arrested, Paul goes willingly. When you read Fox's Book of Martyrs, what did many of the martyrs tell their executioners? You do not need to chain me to the stake. I will stand here while you burn me alive. Why? Because we as Christians don't love our lives. But what do we give our lives for? For the protection of others' lives? For the glory of God? For the advancement of the gospel? So is it wrong for a Christian to be armed? Well, Jesus told them to buy swords, right? There's nothing wrong with a Christian being armed. Okay? Well, what then is that arm supposed to be used for? The defense of human life. Okay? Jesus was willing to go to his trial. If it was illegal to preach the gospel, then I would stand up next to him Sunday morning and I'd preach the gospel. And if the cops came to arrest me, I'd walk outside. I would, and I would go with them to my trial. Okay? I'm not going to fight them over that. I'm not going to resist that. I'm willing to go to prison and die for my faith. Okay? I'm more than willing to do that. That being said, if a terrorist came in here to murder all of our women and children, I'm willing to die protecting them. And it would be the right thing to do for Christian men to fight against those terrorists, even taking their lives, to protect the lives of the women and children. I encourage you to look something up called the, I think I mentioned this last time we talked about this, but I think it's one of the best examples of this doctrine being carried out, is what is known as the St. James Massacre, St. James Day Massacre in South Africa. If you've heard the story, forgive me, but there was a lot of problems in South Africa, and there was a fairly large church that terrorists came into. They came in with machine guns and hand grenades. So you talk about our media tries to make it as we are the most violent culture in the history of the world, yada, 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 yada. You know, these guys literally kicked in the back doors of the church and threw hand grenades in the congregation. Like, just boom, blowing up women and children indiscriminately. And then started shooting fish in a barrel with machine guns, just gunning down all of the church members. There was a guy there that had a 5-shot revolver. He had 5 bullets. And he got down on one knee outside the pew and started shooting back at them. Didn't hit the broadside of a barn. But they saw the muzzle flash, they got scared, and they left. He chased them outside, they got in their vehicles, and they left. Many people died, but his actions God used to save the lives of many, many more people that would have died. Everyone would have died in that building. Okay? That is a correct use of force. It is protecting human life. It is protecting innocent life. This is what militaries are supposed to be for, and that is the defense of human life. This is what police officers are supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be protecting innocent people from those who would steal from them and hurt them. They are supposed to be seeing that the sword, God's righteous judgment, is carried out in accordance with God's law. That's biblical. That's right. That's good. Criminals should be punished. Those who break God's law should be punished. And there is a time when you have to defend human life, okay? And there is nothing wrong with Christians being armed in that regard. But here's where the story doesn't end. The guy who did the who defended his church went, the terrorists were caught, the terrorists were arrested, the terrorists were thrown in prison. He went and visited them in prison so he could look them in the eye, tell them that he forgave them for murdering the people he went to church with, and to share with them the forgiveness that's found in Jesus Christ. He actually led the terrorists to the Lord who killed all of his friends. And then, the laws being what they are in South Africa, a lot of the terrorists got out of prison, and he actually went with those terrorists back to their terrorist organization to share the gospel with their leaders. That is the way Christians are supposed to view this issue. We're not supposed to just let people rape and murder women and innocent children. That's not Christ-like. Okay? Jesus tells them, by a sword. Okay? You can find in Scripture, you look back in God's law, if a man breaks into your house in the middle of the night, you are allowed to do physical violence to him. Why? Because you don't know who he is. You don't know why he's there. Okay? You are not allowed to find him in the daytime. The Scripture is very clear. You can't find him 2 days later and attack him. Okay, we're not talking offensive stuff here. We're talking about render to Caesar what's Caesar's. What's Caesar's job? Caesar's job is to punish those who do evil. And that's what we submit to the government, Romans 13. But our duty is to protect innocent women and children. Our job is to protect the innocent. Jesus does this in several ways. One, encouraging them to be armed. Again, they're not in military gear with night vision and a tank. Okay, they have 2 swords. But it's enough to deter them from being caught up in the violence. Okay? But when they want to attack, Jesus says, no. Go your way. Go your way. gentleman was much more calm and collected than I would be, because he made jokes with the guy who was robbing him. Like, please don't take my driver's license. You know how long the lines are at the DMV? Like, please don't. You know, don't take my driver's license. I'll give you all the cash I have. Could that man have killed the guy, wrestled the gun away from him, all that? Yeah. But in his mind, that robber's life was worth more than the 20 bucks he had in the wallet. He's not going to fight him over it. But if that man had come to do ill to his wife, that would have been an entirely different thing. It's an entirely different matter. So I hope that makes sense. But if any questions or comments on this, because it's something that a lot of Christians I've seen get really hung up on one extreme or the other. One, they get stuck on the extreme of complete pacifism, to where they will just let children be slaughtered and we shouldn't do anything. And other times that you have the offensive, aggressive type approach. Any questions or comments on that? Sure. It is a very difficult question that I don't know that I can give the answer to. I would say that the United States... You would be justified with man. I'm not going to bind someone else's conscience in defense of human life. I will say in a what I view as a similar situation, I believe the United States was right to send our men into Germany to stop the Nazi extermination of Jews. And that took many Nazi lives. Was Dietrich Bonhoeffer right as a pastor to plot the assassination of Hitler? I don't know. Yeah, I can argue either way. I think that that's one of those things that we have to pray and search Scripture in, and I think we also have to be very, very careful that we do not take the sword that God gave in Romans 13 to someone else. Like, vigilante justice is very clearly condemned in Scripture. To me, if someone came into my house to kill my pregnant wife or to kill our pregnant baby, I think that's entirely different than me entering some other facility. But I think that's something that there's a lot of the way where the rubber meets the road is a lot more difficult to articulate than the theories. That's why it's called just war theory. Any other questions or comments?